Okay, great.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this Inside the Museum session, where we interview prominent museum professionals. There's no one more professional or more admired and liked in the profession than our guest this evening, Stephanie Barron. As I'm sure you know, Stephanie is the senior curator and department head of modern art at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. She joined LACMA in 1976 as associate curator of modern art, and it's her 40th anniversary. She's been in various curatorial roles there ever since, along the way curating some stellar exhibitions and producing incredible catalogs for them that have made truly important contributions to art history, and winning all kinds of top prizes and awards for her work too. So let me go take her back to the beginnings now. You're originally from New York, where you had access to a lot of art experiences in a lot of different museums, but is there one thing that happened, or one place maybe, that had a particular effect in getting you hooked on art?
Yeah, there definitely is. I mean, I had the good fortune, first of all, I'm delighted to be here, and I got the blue memo, so. I had the good fortune, my parents liked to travel, so in the summers, we would go to Europe, and, you know, like, I was dragged around to different museums, and I think later my parents couldn't quite believe that I actually then wanted to, you know, go into museum work. But I had seen a lot of things, and I was just always really interested in it. And I went to art classes from second grade to 11th grade every Saturday at the Museum of Modern Art. And not that I'm much of an artist, but I really enjoyed the experience, and, you know, I was 8 years old, and I had a pass. And it's very empowering for a child to walk in to a museum and have this pass and walk past the guard who gets to know you, to walk into where you would do your art classes. And that became a place that I was really comfortable with. It was like my museum. And it's something that I think about a lot. I mean, I spent a lot of time not only doing curatorial, but for a while I was doing kind of education and public programs. And I think that sense of ownership that a child can have from a very early age is really empowering. And it certainly had an effect for me. So I would say MoMA was my, you know, it was my go-to museum. It's still the museum that I'm like, I just, you know, you grow up with pictures and objects, and you form a relationship. So I think that was, for me, really powerful.
So you worked for periods as a young curator at the Jewish Museum and the Guggenheim.
Yeah, I started with the Guggenheim. I went to Barnard College in Columbia and did graduate work at Columbia. And I had taken like a whole lot of art history classes at Barnard, and one semester, Tom Messer, who was then the director of the Guggenheim, would teach a class at Barnard. I had already taken the class, but I kind of was interested that he was coming to teach, so I volunteered for the job to run the slides. That was in the days when there was slide projectors. So I would be tasked with going down to the museum to get the slides and bring them up to Barnard and then run them. So I got to know him. And then the summer after junior year, the Guggenheim had an internship program. So I arrived at the museum, one of 9 interns, and we were supposed to traverse different departments to have a good experience. And he recognized me and he said, "Oh, well, no, my secretary's gone on vacation, so you just come and stay in my office." So my very first museum job was being the secretary to the director of the Guggenheim. And anybody who knows me knows I can't type. So the best typist at the Guggenheim Museum was Tom Messer. Now, I would say that this audience will remember if I say to you, "Do you remember Caraceable paper?" Okay. I try this with another audience, they don't know what I'm talking about. The stationery at the Guggenheim was corrugated paper because nobody typed. But it was an amazing, you know, I saw the museum. It was a very small staff. And then during senior year and subsequent to that, I, you know, came back and then was the curatorial assistant at the Guggenheim. So I kind of grew up at the Guggenheim, and it was a very powerful experience.
So we all know that people in the East Coast art world can be irrationally snobbish about the West Coast. Now, I'm not suggesting that you were, but you what was the attraction of crossing the
whole
country?
Well, I did time in the Midwest.
Oh, so.
So, you know, it's very easy to go from the East Coast to the West Coast, but most people don't drop into the Midwest. So after my master's, I took an internship at the Toledo Museum of Art. I had never been to Ohio. And there were seven of us as museum interns, and it was an internship in education. So we were, it was a kind of a cool class. Christopher Knight was there. And we had an office, there were seven of us. The office was twice the size of this platform. And we gave two tours a day and did classes on Saturday. And Lisa Lyons, who went on the Lannan Foundation, Danielle Rice, who became head of, you know, education at Philadelphia, director of the Delaware Art Museum. There were like seven of us. And it was a great experience. And I had the experience, which was, I'm really glad that I did, because it's very different living in New York or living in LA. I understood how beloved an institution can be in a community. I mean, Toledo has an astonishing collection. And there was a lot of philanthropy of families in the city investing in the museum. And the education program there was profoundly important. It meant that every student from kindergarten to grade 12 went to the museum twice a year. So when I'd go to the grocery store and I'd like be writing a check and I'd have to show my ID, and I would show my Toledo ID, and say, "Oh my God, you work at the Toledo Museum? Oh, I love that Thomas Cole." It's like the woman checking out at Kroger's. Because the museum was part, it wasn't just an elitist place, it was a community place. And that was profoundly important for me. And I think I had also, you know, I was at Columbia, I was at Barnard, in New York, whatever, and my first tour, I was in the galleries. I didn't have much of a contemporary collection. And I was giving a tour, and I was in front of a Hans Hofmann painting, and I was talking about the color theory and the push and the pull and some guy turns to me and he raises his hand and he says, "Why is it art?" And I broke out in a cold sweat. Because nobody at Columbia actually asks you that. So I realized that this was really what museums are about. Museums are about answering that question, not from a textbook, but actually from your heart and your gut, and connecting with your audience. Because if I can't explain to you why it's important to me and what I think you might get from it, it doesn't mean you have to like it. But I learned so much from that year that I'm incredibly glad that I did it. It made me a much better curator, and it made me much more sensitive to the public, I think, than going just from grad school, you know, to a really great, you know, museum job.
Just a footnote to that, Christopher Knight is the art critic for the LA Times. He just wrote a very favorable review of the exhibition that we're sitting in, actually, right. Peter Krasner. Yeah. So we're not going to say anything bad about him ever again. So what was LACMA like when you arrived there in 1976?
It was a small, large museum. It was a large museum with a small collection. But you know, it had basically been founded in the teens, but had only moved to the place where it is now in 1965, so basically 11 years before I got there. But it had a very well-regarded and ambitious exhibition program. And I think it was a decision of the institution, and particularly the person who hired me, which was Maurice Tuckman. And Maurice had actually worked at the Guggenheim, you know, before he came to LACMA. And Maurice produced from 1964 to 1971 an astonishing group of exhibitions. I mean, astonishing, culminating in a certain respect in art and technology in 1971. But one after the other, whether it was American Sculpture of the 60s or Soutine, the New York School, I mean, and they were really ambitious shows. And so the reputation of the institution was not based on its collection, it was based on its exhibitions. And therefore, so when I arrived, it had a modest collection. 2 weeks after I arrived, Maurice left for Europe for about 6 weeks and said, oh, we have to reinstall the collection, so do it. Okay. Remember, I've come from New York and modern, so I go up there and it's like, okay, we start with cubism and like, well, where's the futurism? Oh, it must be in storage. Oh, well, there is no futurism. There is no Picasso cubist painting. There is no Braque cubist painting. So I learned that, again, you have to figure out what's your narrative, and you got to work with what you have. You can't work from your textbook. You have to make some kind of narrative out of what your collection is. So it was a very different institution.
So with that rascal, Maurice Tuckman, you worked on as a first exhibition, I think, or the first major one, perhaps, a show about the Russian avant-garde, right?
Yeah, it was an amazing, it was the first exhibition of the Russian avant-garde in the United States of any consequence. We made the decision, and it turned out to be a very savvy decision. We made the decision, I mean, this is 1980, so we were working on the show from 1977 to when it opened. You know, this is during the Cold War. You couldn't, all the Russian avant-garde works, Malevich, Lazitsky, Rodchenko, Popova, all of those works that were in the Soviet museums were in the basement, and they were forbidden to be shown. And only starting in 1974 were there a few examples of that sent out, but only in the context of a big exhibition that would include socialist realism, which of course was what, you know, became the kind of prevailing aesthetic. So maybe they would send a Kandinsky, you know, with, you know, tons of this social realist stuff. And often you couldn't rely upon what they were going to send until you opened the box. So we made the decision very early on to do the exhibition without a single Soviet loan, because we were convinced that enough material had found its way to the West that we could do it that way. Turned out to be a really smart decision, because 6 months before we opened, Afghanistan happened, and we would have had no loans. So it was smart. And we found amazing material. We were the first museum to show the Kostakis collection before the Guggenheim showed it. And I kind of cut my teeth on doing interesting exhibition design, because we invited Frank Gehry to do the design of the exhibition. And I've now done shows with Frank from that till last year. And it's a wonderful collaboration. I learn a lot and he learns a lot, and he certainly doesn't need the job. But in 1979, when we started working on it, if you think about Gehry's architecture in the 70s, I mean, it was a lot of exposed plywood. There was a constructivist sensibility, and so he totally got off on all the material we were finding. We had plywood walls in the exhibition. It was really, we had exposed studs. I mean, it was very cool, and I learned that through that. I mean, Frank really taught me how to design an exhibition, and how to think about things in a unfolding a story. And I continue to like to go to him. One of the most recent ones that I did that I thought was really interesting was the Calder exhibition. I don't know if you saw that. And I wasn't thinking of going to Frank, but we had just done the Ken Price exhibition before, and Ken and Frank were really, really, really close friends. And so I knew Frank would do that. And I don't know, about a week after that show opened, I was in the studio, and he said, "Well, what are you working on next?" And I said, "I'm doing a Calder show." And he said, "Well, you want to do it together?" And I said, "Really?" He said, "Oh, I love Calder, kind of guilty pleasure." And I said, "Sure, I'd love to." And one of the challenges of the Calder exhibition, particularly a sculpture exhibition where something moves, is how do you let the pieces be free without barriers, and without kind of, what I didn't want was, you know, kind of big platforms under everything, which I thought a lot of Calder shows didn't look so good. And I always think you go to the smartest person you know to solve the problem. And I said to Frank, everything has to be 36 inches away from the public. So he designed this installation where you never realized that there was that barrier, because he worked it into kind of the aesthetics and the design of the exhibition. And, you know, he just solved the problem.
So what was it like working with Frank Gehry on an exhibition of his own work? And because there is always this...
He didn't. I mean, as Frank said, you know, the guys in the office will do this. Well, if you work with Frank, yeah, he'll come to a meeting, he'll look at it, and he'll move a little this and move a little that. And then, but he really left this to the other people in the studio. I mean, he would like veto something if he didn't like it. But you know, artists, my experience is, you know, like in a retrospective, artists are really not interested in looking back. I mean, Frank was 86 years old when we did the show. He's much more interested in what's going on now. He's interested in the river. He's interested in, you know, buildings that he's doing all over the world. He is not interested in looking back at houses that didn't happen in the 1960s. So he understands that it's important, but it's not really how he wants to invest his energy. And I find that's true of a lot of artists.
I'd like to get on now to the wonderful series of exhibitions that you've created on modern German art. The LA Times once commented that you've presented, quote, "craggy mountains of art to people who prefer soft fields of flowers." And I'm sure what they meant was that you haven't done much on the French Impressionists.
I haven't.
You know, you've avoided obvious crowd-pleasing topics like that. And probably your most acclaimed show about German art was the recreation of the modern art show that the Nazis staged in 1937, Degenerate Art, which the Association of International Art Critics awarded its prize for the best American exhibition of the year in 1991. And I'm sure a lot of people agreed that it was the best exhibition that year. It was probably, some people remember it. I certainly do. So where did the idea of doing that particular recreative show come from?
I think it's something that I had been interested in since the early 1980s. I did a show on German Expressionist sculpture in 1982, I think. And one of the things that I found as I was digging around to find these sculptures that the German Expressionists made was that a lot of them had been destroyed. And I would find them in old catalogs, and then I found that in this little pamphlet that was published for the Degenerate Art Show, little pamphlet, maybe 32 pages, four pages with four photographs per page had sculptures. And I was like, and they're all destroyed. And I thought, wow, if in 1937 sculpture was privileged so much, and these were wood carvings, some painted, some not painted. And I thought, well, if they were so important then, what happened to them? So it just kind of was planted back then. I thought, how could there only be this one little pamphlet for this show that was supposed to have had 600 works of art in it and toured to 13 German and Austrian cities and attracted over 1 million visitors? At the time, it was the biggest blockbuster that had ever been mounted. So I was kind of interested in I was kind of fascinated with it. I had long been interested in the notion of recreation. Mm-hmm. And that happened because of a show that I saw at the Museum of Modern Art when I was in college that was done about the Gertrude Stein collection. And the modern four collectors bought most of the Stein collection that was being sold. And the Museum of Modern Art did an exhibition that kind of recreated the rooms and things like that. I think I went to the show about 30 times. I was fascinated with it because it was a way of kind of like transporting myself back to Paris, you know, in those times and seeing these paintings and seeing these photo blow-ups. So I was interested in that notion of recreation. So I started to kind of dig around to kind of what was in that original show. And so I was spending a lot of time in Germany on then another exhibition on second generation German Expressionism. And I took an apartment in Berlin for about 3-4 months. And I had heard, in 1987 was the 50th anniversary of degenerate art, and a lot of museums were beginning to do research on what had happened to their own collections during the Nazi era. And so I was kind of beginning to hear stuff, you know, that Essen was doing something or Munich was doing something, so that there was research beginning to be done. And I heard a rumor that, remember, this is when Cold War, so there's still East Berlin and West Berlin. So I heard a rumor that there were installation photographs of the original exhibition in the archives of the National Gallery in East Berlin. So I had a car and I would like drive across, you know, Checkpoint Charlie every day. I went through so many times that they used to have to exchange a certain amount of hard currency. The guides just like waved me through and I didn't have to exchange this useless currency every day. So I got to the museum and was in the archives, and the woman who ran it was really smart and was kind of interesting. And after about 5 visits, you know, she produced 75 photographs of the original exhibition, which was nobody had seen. So the first was, so what do I want to do? I said, you know, can I get copies of them? No, it's not possible. Can I take pictures of them? No, it's not possible. Can I bring in a photocopy? We don't have a photocopy machine. Can I bring one in? No. So I thought, what am I going to do? And the photograph, yeah, I steal them, I'll end up in prison. I wasn't going that route. And what you have to realize is that the photographs of the exhibition had were little labels next to it, handwritten labels, and the labels had the name of the artist, the name of the work, the museum from which it was taken, and how much that museum had spent for the work of art. So it was a really good, and there were all these derogatory comments. But the most important thing were those labels and the image. So what did I do? I got a notebook, and I had to, with a magnifying glass, and I sketched each one of those photographs. And I would drive back to my apartment in West Berlin, and I would type it up, and I would, you know, try to recreate a checklist. and it took me 2 weeks. Eventually I got those photographs, and eventually she wrote for my catalog and all of that, but I had to build a checklist. And when I tell this to like young museum curators, they go, you like sketched it. You know, I mean, the concept of, you know, something not being online, you know, this is about as far from online as you can imagine. So it took a year to kind of recreate this checklist, but you know, you don't have a show from that because now you have to go find it. So then it's like, well, how do you find where these things are? Well, some of them are famous, so you can go through a complete catalog of an artist's work and you can kind of try to track it that way. And other times you have to go back to the museum from which it had been taken and see if they have any files. So it was basically 3 years of detective work. And we ended up with 180 works of art that were in the original exhibition. And it was, it was pretty amazing. And Frank designed that too.
So you followed up with other German shows, Exiles and Emigres in 1997. And most recently, just last year, in fact, the wonderful New Objectivity show. So shows like that, they do great things to enhance the appreciation of German art. But still, I don't know if I'm putting words in your mouth, but still German art, I think, compared with French, say, in this country, is a little bit unloved.
No, I think it's true. And I have to say that, you don't start out a career, I mean, I had a job. You don't start out a career thinking, I'm going to create this body of work. It kind of happens. And we've built an audience. And when I talk to, we'll have an opening and the German press will come or whatever, and they'll say to me, with all seriousness, is anybody interested in this here? And then, you know, every one of those shows has had over 100,000 visitors. And trust me, there's no marketing, because there's never been a dollar of corporate support for these shows. I could not have done these shows, particularly early ones, without the National Endowment for the Arts and the National Endowment for the Humanities. Impossible without them. Impossible. Not a dime of corporate money. Because it's tough art. It's not attractive sometimes to some people. But I also think that the public, it's work that really resonates for people. And I mean, I've talked to a couple of people here who, remembered certain, I'll run into somebody and say, I really remember that sculpture show from 1982. I mean, this is powerful work and it stays with you. So I actually think we've built a really sophisticated audience in Southern California for this material in ways that do not exist in almost any other place in the United States. Mm. And it there's a kind of consistency, and I didn't start out planning this, but kind of one thing leads to another. And you also get to know colleagues. It makes loans are easier because, people know your work. And, the first time I went to try to go borrow German art for a museum in Los Angeles, they laughed at me. They had no idea. And then, I did the show, and, the first reaction on the Germans' part was, well, we don't need an American to, do our art for us. Well, then the shows would go to Germany. And the press would say, well, why did it take an American to do a show about you? and the Degenerate Art Show ended up going to Germany. And it had 350,000 visitors. Wow. Because there was a hunger, because this is material that had been deep-sixed. This is material that, and it was right after the wall came down, and it was in actually former East Berlin, and the communists had during East Germany there was no awareness of this whatsoever. It was like a double kind of amnesia. So I don't know, it's I've found that really fascinating, and the more you spend time there, the more you get to know. And then, you know, I've probably seen more German museums than most German colleagues.
And the German government's given you a couple of awards, right? Can you tell us what they are in German?
The Verdienstkreuz Erste Klasse. Yeah, so I have the Order of Merit First Class and then the Commander's Cross. You know,
are they actual medals?
Actual medals, but you're only allowed to. You get a little one, like a, you know, a teeny little version. It's not nearly as nice as, you know, if I'd worked in French art, I'd get, you know, that nice little thing.
Oh, the Legion d'Honneur.
Yeah. No, ours is just like this little kind of ribbon, but the really cool one, you're only allowed to wear with white tie, and I don't get invited to too many white tie events.
So you've also curated two David Hockney exhibitions, including Hockney Portrait Show, which was in 2006, and I think probably about that time, right? David Hockney painted a portrait of you.
No, that was about 2 years ago.
Oh, was it? Oh, yeah. More recently then. So what was that like? What was it like to sit for him?
It was thrilling, I have to say. There's a show that is closing in about 3 weeks in London at the Royal Academy, and it's called 82 Portraits in One Still Life. And when David moved back to Los Angeles, he'd spent about 7 years in Yorkshire doing a lot of wonderful landscapes. And he came back to the studio. David's also about 80% deaf. So being out in groups and everything is very, very, very difficult. But he enjoys conversation, he enjoys people. And my theory is that he turned to these portraits. He did a setup. It's like we were on like a riser like this, and everybody whose portrait he did sits in the same chair with the same background, and the only thing that's different is what you wear and how you sit. And he doesn't tell you what to wear, and it's a 3-day commitment. It's 5 hours for the first 2 days, and the third day is, you know, kind of catch up. You get lunch in between. He also, you know, is a nonstop smoker. He doesn't smoke when he paints. And every hour or hour and 15 minutes, there was a break, so he could smoke. But you could get off the platform and you sit and chat with him, and then you could look and see, you know, what was happening. As an art historian and as a curator, it was an astonishing experience to just watch a great artist paint a portrait. You know, it made it, you know, weird that it was me, but I felt like it was at this time that I was writing my essay for my new objectivity catalog, for which, many of the artists at that time were doing portraits. And I found I had a much different appreciation and understanding for the work that I was writing about by just the experience of watching David paint a portrait. And those paintings, the 82, are on view in the Royal Academy right now. You know, they're all exactly the same size. And it's really fascinating. We'll bring the show here in 2018. It'll be traveling around. But it was an astonishing experience. Hmm.
So one of the many strings to your bow is California art. You know, we think of David Hockney as one of the great California artists, even though he's a Brit, of course. And you were much involved in the Made in California exhibition at LACMA in 2000-2001, which in a way was sort of the forerunner for that great Getty Pacific Standard Time initiative of a couple of years ago that really promoted and increased people's interest in California art. So it's a deeply interesting subject to us here at Laguna Art Museum, because that's our specialty, mm-hmm. of course, is California art. Do you feel like things are on the up for California art as far as its reputation nationally and internationally is concerned? We hope so.
I hope so too. And I'd say that, and I would say it's not an unqualified yes. I would say that a lot, I think there is a lot of interest, but I think the situation within the contemporary art market today is that it's very much market connected. And we were talking about this mm-hmm. earlier. There's a real interest in, you know, digging up artists from the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, you know, the kind of the overlooked, many of whom happen to have been in California, by galleries in Europe or in New York. So you're seeing a kind of a rekindling of interest in artists from the 60s in the marketplace, and with really big prices. And that gets the attention of people. But it's, I think, very much market connected. And many of them were artists who I think dealers discovered during all the Pacific Standard Time stuff. I mean, I think Made in California was probably a little ahead of its time in a funny way. I do think it was a precursor to the PST shows. It was a show that was much loved by the public and almost universally detested by the art press. I probably got the worst reviews I've ever gotten, ever, for an exhibition that I thought was really important. And why? Because we had the audacity to mix high and low. The audacity. And that's what Roberta Smith, you know, wrote. And it was a cheapening, you know, it was, and yet, if you were to do that now, you know, for sure, that it'd be weird to not do it. But I think there's just so much good material that hasn't been seen and hasn't gotten much of an audience, that I think it's really ripe for a continued kind of re-exploration. But I do think it's very much market connected. So that if the deal, I mean, Ken Price, all right? Ken Price, well known and always put into exhibitions of ceramics and clay. How do museums categorize them? In an encyclopedic museum, they stick them in decorative arts. Why? Because it's made out of ceramic, because you make teacups out of ceramic? It made me crazy. And I mean, I had to train our press office and marketing and all that stuff, and I said, you may not call him a ceramicist. The docents, we had a whole thing. You may not call him a ceramicist. He's a sculptor. You know, do you talk about Richard Serra by the nature of what his material is? No. So I, because it becomes a pejorative and it lessens it. And Ken Price's stock rose when Matthew Marks took him on. And suddenly he was presented, and also Ken's work was becoming increasingly since 1980, much more sculptural. And what Matthew Marks was showing was the recent work. So there was no question that that was sculpture. So when I was thinking about how to install that exhibition, the light bulb went on, and I said, I have to install this exhibition in reverse chronological order. If I started that exhibition with a bunch of cups, forget it. Mm-hmm. Forget it. It never would have done for him what that show needed to do and what it did do. Reverse chronological order was a walk in the park. And it was like, oh, thank God I thought of that. So, you know, I think there is interest, and I think it's, and I think it is growing. Mm-hmm. But I think it is connected to the market.
So, we can't complain when the market does bring to the world's attention a really great artist, but I suppose the downside is that it's all so random. So there might be an artist like John McLaughlin, for example, who doesn't isn't a darling of the market.
I mean, we're talking about this. I mean, I'm doing a John McLaughlin retrospective.
Which opens in November.
Opens in November, and you're very generously lending to it. John McLaughlin, I mean, an interesting story, you know, died in 1976, worked nearby, worked in his garage, bought his canvases at Sears.
They lived in Dana Point, right?
Dana Point. Didn't exactly, you know, do a lot of conservationally sensitive preparation of his canvases. He died in 76, left everything to his widow, Florence. She died very shortly thereafter. She left everything to Nick Wilder, who was his gallerist in Los Angeles, who had upped and left Los Angeles and moved to New York and become a painter. He died about a year later of AIDS, left the estate to his brother, who shortly died, and left it. Yeah, so, I mean, so, no, sorry, he let, no. Nick died, left it to his partner. The partner died, and it was left to the partner's brother. And that is the person who holds the copyright for John McLaughlin. He doesn't exactly do much to exercise it. And he sold stuff. He didn't really know what he was doing, dumped a lot of stuff. So there is no cache of material for a dealer to market. There's no body of material that can escalate in price. And if there were, John McLaughlin would be selling for $1 million. With no question in my mind. Instead, I'm doing this show. I tried 35 museums to travel the show to, and not one would take it.
Museums outside of California, presumably.
Yeah, I mean, mostly. There's no point in doing that and sending it to San Francisco. I mean, your point of doing a show like this and traveling it. It was why, you know, I didn't want to send it to some, you know, museum that was going to get 9,000 visitors. I mean, there's no point to that. The point is to do the show and expand the audience and the appreciation for the work. I don't need just a venue. It's about who's going to be able to see it.
Yeah.
I mean, Ken Price went to the Nasher and then it went to the Metropolitan Museum of Art. You know, that was a big deal.
So you've always been a curator. You must have been courted quite often by high-level museums to become a museum director. I'm not saying it's a good idea.
Well, you know, I had a kind of a way to try it out because after Rusty Powell left LACMA to become director of the National Gallery, we hired a director who had been a curator at a Midwestern museum, and he didn't last very long. And so we had no directors. So I was like running the curatorial side of things, and we had a kind of county guy who was doing all the money. And I did that for a little over two years. So I kind of had a taste of it. And I will say that, you know, early on you think, oh, you know, you're a good curator, and like the next step is to become a director. Well, one of the things that I learned was I think if you're going to be a really good director, your job is to allow your curators to do the very best work that they can do. And I will confess that I was too selfish. I wanted to do that work myself. And I mean, I can raise money and I can organize stuff, but it's my passion truly is doing what I think is the most privileged job that I can think of. The idea of being able to imagine a topic and delve into it, have access to the world's experts, actually find the material and bring it together and tell a story, doesn't get any better than that for me. You know, and I always tell, you know, junior curators, I said, the very best moment in a curator, you worked five, it takes me 5 years to do these big shows, 5-6 years, is the night before the show opens. You've written the book, which you've had to write from photographs or having traveled around and seen everything. But suddenly, that night before, everything's arrived, labels are up, there have been no reviews, no parties, and I always spend about 5 or 6 hours the night before. And it's the single best, and I spent 5 years for that one night. Because it's like, now you really could write the book. Because now you actually have, you may know all those works individually, but only at that night do you have it actually all assembled to tell the story physically that you've imagined for 5 years. And I don't know, to me it's like theater. You know, it's like, it's just, there's a magic to it that I think it's just amazing. So I think it excites me still, and I love doing it, and I love installing. And I think being able to convey that story to an audience is a real privilege. So I'd rather do that than raise money.
You do it fabulously well. Well, let me open things up now. Would you like to ask a question? Yes, yes.
That means a lot to me, because I got a lot of grief at certain points for putting all that archival material in there. In fact, and somebody said, well, why are you putting it all in here? Half of it's in German. And I said, because there's something incredibly powerful about actual documents. And I've become like a document junkie. I mean, I really think that there is something about those documents. I mean, for me, the most powerful documents, there were two. One was the list of the burned books, where we actually had copies of the registers when the Nazis in the 1930s basically had a list of, you know, the authors who were to be banned, and they were pulled out of the libraries and set on fire. So we actually got copies, we actually got some of the actual registers, you know, where they crossed off, you know, Ernest Hemingway and, you know, Thomas Mann. They were all crossed off. So that was very powerful. And the other was, there was a sale in 1939 in Switzerland where the Nazis sold 125 works of art that were taken from German museums for hard currency. And there was an actual catalog of those, of what was sold, but it only illustrated 50% of what was sold. And so I went to the auction house, which is still in business today, and went into their archives, or I asked if I could, and I had free rein in that archives. It was the first person in there, and I asked if, you know, I could borrow some of the stuff, and they said, sure. And I thought it would never show up. I had the contract with the Nazis. I had the bidding cards. I had the shipping records. And the most astonishing thing was I said, well, do you have any, 125 works, there were like 60 photographs in the catalog, auction catalog. And I said, well, are there any more photographs? She went into said, I think so. And there was a rubber band around a bunch of photographs. Every work of art had a photograph. They'd only published half of them. And I said, well, can I borrow these? Sure. So we were actually able to republish and then track where they are the 125 works. Just because I went and asked. So having that whole display case with the stuff from the Fisher sale was, for me, really powerful.
Mm-hmm.
Any other question? Yes. Sure.
The question is to talk about valuation of paintings and the steep rise. Do you mean like the craziness of the art market? It's so depressing. It's really depressing because it's become such a commodity. And I have to say that, you know, when I started at LACMA, you know, we were modern art, but we did contemporary. I mean, there wasn't such a division of modern and contemporary. And about, I don't know, about 10 years ago, we bifurcated modern and contemporary. And at first, I wasn't sure how I felt about that. I'm really happy to, I mean, I see all the shows and I do, it's just become, I find that the astonishing prices for emerging artists is just crazy. And, you know, for your, artists come out now and they think if they're 28 and they're not selling for, you know, $250,000, that there's something wrong. And I just think it's out of whack. So, and it becomes very speculative. And it becomes very much, the marketing of it, I think, just offends me a lot. So I am very happy to have a little bit of a distance from that. And I find just the, you know, even just among collectors, trustees, you know, how does that, you know, who's buying what and how does it affect what shows, one's being pressured to, you know, exhibit and which artists. I don't particularly enjoy that aspect of it. So I find it troubling. Yeah, I mean, I think it is. I don't think it's really something you want to try to figure out because it's really it's very tough and it's. We keep waiting for it to, you know, the bubble to burst, but so far it doesn't seem to be doing that.
Yes.
Can you speak a little bit to the future of Black Man, the new building, and, you know, the whole sort of look?
Sure.
And the new film?
Sure.
From your point of view, how you see that?
Sure, I think. So the question is about, you know, LACMA, expansion, the relationship to the film museum. You know, first of all, I think having the film museum in LA is like, duh, we didn't have one. So I think it's great, and they've certainly wanted one for a long time. So we leased basically the May Company, which we had bought, so we leased it to them. And Renzo Piano is doing that. So I think. Oh, 18. So it's they're in heavy construction now. They've staffed up and all that stuff. So I think that's going to be terrific. I think there's a huge appetite for that, and it's not going to just be a Hollywood museum. I mean, I think they've added curators, you know, from the German Film Museum, and you know they're really going about it, I think, in a really interesting way. So having them as neighbors to do that is fabulous. You know, what's going to happen with our own campus? We've engaged Peter Zumthor, a very distinguished Pritzker Prize winning Swiss architect, who has really never built in the United States. He's in his 70s, late 70s. And he is he's an architect who creates some of the most beautiful, ethereal spaces with a remarkable quality of light. So this is by far the biggest project that he's ever done. We had investigated years ago kind of an expansion before we built the Resnick Pavilion and the Broad Contemporary Art building. And we at that point had engaged Rem Koolhaas, who had a proposal, I'm sure you remember, where we would have, you know, raised the campus. We would have had to shut down for several years. Eventually we decided not to go that route. For a variety of reasons. Once we built BCAM and Resnick, we actually, you know, wouldn't have to close down, So we have, you know, the whole campus now, from the restaurant and the bar, going west with activity. We have, you know, a lot of space to both do exhibitions and show aspects of the collection. So the concept of tearing down the East Campus was suddenly not as disastrous as it was, you know, 14 years ago. So Peter's been working on this very closely with our director, Michael Govan, with the idea that this is, you know, a single-story museum. I think the feeling, Michael's feeling, is that you lose audiences every floor you go up. So the idea is to have, you know, a single level. We are neighbors with, you know, we're in Hancock Park. There is a very active, you know, the Tar Pit Museum. So there's, when our neighbors are, you know, one of the satellites of the Natural History Museum. So there is a lot of concern for the ecosystem, if you will, of Hancock Park. So originally the design of the building was all on the Hancock Park site, but Natural History had some concerns about the scale of the building and the, you know, how it might affect the ecosystem. So they switched and decided to bridge Wilshire, because we also own the parking lot on Spalding, kind of just across the street. So that's kind of where we are now, that it will do, that's what it will do. The ETA on that is, you know, if you come to the museum, it's like really a mess on the street, because they're building the subway, they're extending the subway. So the idea is that we should be open by 2023 when the subway stop opens at Wilshire and Fairfax. I think we're moving in that direction, and I think there's a huge, I mean, there's a little impediment of having to still raise a fair amount of money. But the county is definitely, you know, we are the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. We have one of the most remarkable public-private partnerships in the United States, and certainly in terms of an art museum, the best. And the county has always been very supportive, and the way it always works is the private side, which in our case is called Museum Associates, DBA, Los Angeles County Museum of Art, Museum Associates pays to build the building, and when it's built, we give it to the county in exchange for some operating costs. So we get, at this point, a third of our budget, a little more than a third of our budget from the county every year, just as a cash grant. So the county's behind it. The county has agreed, pending, you know, successful environmental impact report, et cetera, et cetera. They have pledged $120 million towards it. We need 600, so they've pledged 120, and then there is, you know, money that we have to raise on the private side, and then there will be a bond for, you know, a slice of it. So we still have, have some money in hand, and basically, you know, the formulas, you're supposed to raise like 60% of your money from around your boardroom table, so I'd say we're still going around the table. Yeah, good thinking.
Oh yes, one last question.
Okay, first of all, be a really good art historian. And don't take how to be curator, you know, certificate programs. I think that's like, I don't know, I'm of the school of thought that, I'm of the school of thought that we are art historians who have a passion for working with objects and the public. And I think what I do comes from being a good art historian and wanting to make that connection. It doesn't come from, I don't know. It just, for me, that's how it is. So if you've taken those courses, you've learned some technical stuff, but you could learn that, you know, on the job. But getting hired, I mean, I don't hire people who only have that. I mean, I've had interns who come that way. And I would say also that depends on what area of the museum you want to work in. Most people want to work in contemporary. And I find that people who work in who work only in contemporary and are trained only in contemporary think that Andy Warhol is, you know, like Rembrandt. And I think that does a disservice to artists, because artists know art history. Good artists really know art history. And if you're a contemporary curator and you can't keep pace with a conversation with a really good artist about Titian and about Courbet, you're a producer. You're not a curator. You're a producer who's then going to make possible what the artist envisions, but you're not going to really be able to get into a good discourse about it conceptually or intellectually. So I think you need to be as prepared as a good artist is, and that requires really knowing your stuff in terms of art history. That's my opinion.
Well, thank you so much, Jan, for that. Congratulations on your 40 years at LACMA. And if things don't work out in the end, there's always a job for you here at Laguna Art Museum.
I must say, I went in for a walk after I got here. This is really beautiful. Anyway, it was a pleasure, and I'm a huge fan of your director, and
thank
really,
you,
you're very lucky to have him.
Thank you.